Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the session we come to now. We bless your name for how you have brought us together so we can bear fruit. And we pray, O Lord, that as we look into your word now, you will speak to our hearts and you help us to bear fruit in Jesus' name. We pray that you help us to see what is essential and what you require from every life as we present ourselves to you as workers in the vineyard of the Lord. We pray that through this message, you will change our hearts, change our attitude, and help us to concentrate on what is actually essential in your work, in our service, in Jesus' name. We pray that none of us will remain as we were before after a message like this. In Jesus' name, we pray. Matthew chapter 28, we're looking at verses 19 and 20. These are the very words of Jesus Christ after he rose from the dead. In chapter 28 of Matthew, verse 19, it says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Amen. Jesus Christ, as the head of the church, gave the great commission to the church, the whole church. And he commanded the whole church that this should be the assignment that we concentrate upon from the time he gave out that great commission unto the very end of the world, which means this is to go through the whole church age. It wasn't just for the early church. It wasn't just for the first 100 years of the church. And it wasn't for just the anointed time or the revival time or the time when the Spirit of God had been mightily poured out and they were doing great exploits for the Lord. Whether it was at the early time or in the dark ages or at this time now when the end is about to come, it tells us that this should be the involvement and the work the church should do. And it says to the very end of the world. In the Greek, it means to the very end of the age of this dispensation in which we find ourselves. It tells us what to do. It tells the church, go. Obviously, that was telling the church they will start in Jerusalem, but then they will have to go away from Jerusalem and spread beyond Jerusalem. It said, go ye, which means he was talking to them. It wasn't an assignment for the angels. He was talking to these people that he had redeemed. And he said, go ye. Then he said, go ye therefore. He was telling them they were not to look into themselves. They were to look into his own power. Because he had said in verse 18, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. It's therefore saying, therefore. Because all power has been given unto me. Because of the sovereignty of God, because of the power of God, and because of the exaltation of Jesus Christ, go ye therefore. When you go, you are not just to go and sightsee. You are not just to go and have pleasure. You are not just to go and see what is going on from tribe to tribe, from nation to nation. You are to go and teach. Which means go is not enough. We cannot say, oh yes, we have scattered ourselves all abroad, all about. Go and do something. Don't go and trade. Don't go and just live there. Don't go and find pleasure. Don't go and join yourself to the people of the tribes and of the nations. Go and teach. And what are they teaching? They are teaching the very word of the Lord. They are teaching from the very foundation, the basics of what Jesus gave out. Repentance unto the Lord and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ to bring them into the kingdom. Now, which places were they to go and teach? It said all nations. Actually, in the Greek, it means all ethnic tribes. It means all people. You see, there is a kind of boundary that you think about when you think of the national boundaries. You see that on the map. But the Lord was not talking on boundaries in the map. He was talking of the boundaries of the languages. And over here in this nation, for example, you have boundaries that determine languages rather than just boundaries that determine the geography. And so he says, go ye therefore and teach. Who are we to teach? All nations, that is all ethnic groups, all tribes, wherever they are found. And then as they respond, because you have to join Mark to this, he that believeth and is baptized. And so in between teaching all nations and the baptism is teaching them so convincingly that they actually believe. And when they believe, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And you will realize that over there is no full stop. You see, many evangelists will read this passage and they put a full stop at the end of verse 19. And in fact, they put their full stop at the end of the nations. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. They do not even care to baptize in water. And you will hear of evangelists that will leave their native land. And it will come to our place here. It may be to Accra, it may be to Kumasi or to any other city. And once they have the stadium kind of program, and they have made the altar call, or maybe they don't even make the altar call, while all the people are there, they raise up their hands. After the raising up their hands, they say, wow, wonderful, that all our country has been brought to the Lord already. And they will say, don't you see? They say, wave those hands at me. And they will wave their hands. And they will say, look at that. It's like the ripened harvest of the field. That all of this city already, they have given themselves to the Lord. As they wave their hands like that, they say, keep on waving that hand. I like to see those hands. It is a symbol, a mark that all this nation is now giving to the Lord. And then after that, we count the offering. And after counting the offering, then we make some announcements. After making some announcements, we distribute some papers and we distribute some books. And then evangelist, after about 3-4 days he has done that, you want to see him for counseling whether you have assurance of salvation or not, but he has gone back to his land or gone back to another crusade. That is not what Jesus said. You see, there is no full stop after go ye therefore. There's a command. And teach all nations, there's a command. Baptizing them, you cannot stop when there is no full stop. You cannot say, I have ended my work, when the sentence had not ended. Therefore, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And he didn't say you should commit the water baptism into the hands of the people you know nothing about. You see, if you come to evangelize, if you come to preach, you are to go through all the whole thing and make sure that these people really have believed, they have been converted, and they are baptized in water. And then it says, after you have baptized them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, you have not ended. There's no full stop yet. Now, teaching them. Teaching them. Teaching them. What are you to teach them? And who are these people that you are to teach? You see, in verse 19, there is a big kind of crowd. You are teaching those people to come to know the Lord. That is teaching the world that they ought to know the Lord. But you see, now they have believed and they have been baptized in water. After they are baptized in water, what does that mean? He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. They are saved. If they are saved, where are they now? They are no more in the world. They are now in the kingdom of God. This teaching them is teaching them now inside the kingdom. In verse 19, go ye therefore, you go to the world and teach all nations. You are teaching them while they are in the world. You are calling them by that teaching, convincing them by that teaching that Jesus is the Christ, that Jesus is the Savior, that Jesus is the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. And when they come to the realization that we know and believe, not just because we have said it, but because we have heard and we have seen him ourselves, that this is the Savior, our Savior and the Savior of the world. And they say, we believe, like the eunuch of Ethiopia, when it says when he said, this is water, what hinders me to be baptized? And Philip said, if you believe that Jesus is the Christ, you can be baptized. And he said, with all my heart, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. What are we told in Romans? We are told, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. With that confession, now he can be baptized in water. when they are baptized in water, they are already in the kingdom of God. Because you must be born again. It is that new birth, being born again, that ushers you into the kingdom of God. And now that you are in the kingdom of God, teaching them to observe. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Now, do you see, it says, you teach all nations. In all those nations, in all those language groups, you now teach them, those who believe, you now teach them all things whatsoever I have commanded you. That's why it is the same doctrine. Whether it is in this tribe, or that nation, or that other nation, it is still the same doctrine. Because Jesus said, you are going to continue teaching them all things whatsoever, I have commanded you. And then it says, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. You know, as I read this, when it says, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. You know what I remember? I remember the Old Testament. As the children of Israel were moving out of Egypt, and they were going and going and going. And then God gave them a symbol of his presence, the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire. And we're told in that story in Exodus that wherever the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire stopped, they stopped. And it may stop for about a few days. And when the pillar moved again, they kept on moving. And here, look at this. It says, I'm with you always till the end of the world. You know what I believe? I believe that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is with the church in this way, that he stays here now. And he allows us to do some real evangelistic work. And when he sees that much is done there, he tells us to leave some people behind to continue with them. And then the pillar of cloud moves and we move. But the surprising thing is that the Lord is willing to move and go with us. But the church is staying. The church says, we've got a big church in Kumasi here. Therefore now we can stay here and rest. All the other villages, that we shouldn't worry about them now. See what God has done for our church. A big, big church here. And the church says, we have that big church in Accra over there. And see this great church here. Now we are just to stay and just be teaching the people. There are still other tribes and other languages and other people that are there. And we're to keep on reaching to them. And as long as the pillar of cloud is moving, you keep on moving. As long as the pillar of fire is moving, you keep on moving. As long as the Lord is pulling you and pushing you and convicting you and drawing you and saying, there's still a tribe over there, there's still an individual over there, there's still some pockets of people over there, you keep on reaching out to them. And so that's why we want to talk about this important subject today, and it is evangelism, training and practice. I'm going to talk on three major points, and these are really major points. Number one, the priority of evangelism. The priority of evangelism. Number two, training for evangelism. And number three is the practice of evangelism. Number one is the priority of evangelism. Now, when we say something is a priority, it means it comes as number one on the list. It must be so. That it must be number one on the list. On the agenda of the Lord Jesus Christ, when he came into this world, he made evangelism number one. The number one job. It was a priority for the Lord Jesus Christ. In calling the disciples to himself, he made the evangelism the priority of their call. He didn't say, follow after me and I will turn out theologians of you. He didn't say, follow after me, and I'm going to make seminarians out of you. He didn't say, follow me, and I'm going to do this and do this through you. He said, follow me, and I will make you the fishers of men. He made the call. He made the evangelism the priority of the call. And you will see from his own agenda, his personal life, his activity, you will see that he went about forgiving sin and healing the sick. And he said, the Son of Man has not come like a physician to heal the people that are well or to come for the righteous, but he comes to call the sinners unto repentance. And you will see in all the people he dealt with, whether as individuals and as groups as well, he made evangelism his priority. And you will see whenever he did miracles in some places and the people were not evangelized or they refused to repent, he will cry over them, "Woe unto you, Chorazin, if the miracles, the mighty works that had been done in you had been done in Sodom and Gomorrah, they would have remained until this day. But thou Capernaum, although you are lifted up to heaven, you'll be brought down to hell because you did not repent." And when the people sought for a sign, and he said, "Show us a sign that you are the one to be expected." He said, "There is no sign to be given unto you except the sign of Jonah. And then a greater than Jonah is here." Because Jonah went to Nineveh and those people repented. But here comes the Son of Man, and he has given you the word and you have not repented. You will see the priority of his agenda, the priority of his heartbeat, and the priority of his activity, the priority of everything he did was that evangelism. The Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. Now let's look at some references in Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1 from verse 30 says, "And Simon and they that were with him followed after him. And when they had found him, they said unto him, All men seek for thee." You know what they were telling him? They were telling him, "You are now popular, you are famous. In fact, they have heard your name and all men are looking for you." Look at his priority now in verse 38. "And he said unto them, Let us go, let us go, let us go into the next towns, that I may preach there also, for therefore came I forth." You see the priority there? You know, he had been praying. If you look at verse 35 early in the morning, he went to a solitary place and there prayed. And now in verse 36, the people, his disciples, came unto him and they said, "All the people are looking for you. They want more miracles. They want to see more signs and wonders. They want to see a lot of things that they have been expecting. And you know the things you've done. You've cleansed the lepers. You've done this. You've done that. Now they want to see more of that." He said, "We must go to the next town." What are we going to do in the next town? To preach there also. I'm sure that you as students of English, you'll know when we use the word also. It means we've done it here. Go, let us go and do it there also. It means the thing we did over here in the past, we're not going to move out and we're going to do that same thing there also. Then he said, "Because of that, for that reason have I come forth, for therefore came I forth." So then you can see the priority of the Lord Jesus Christ in Luke chapter 19 and verse 10. Luke chapter 19 verse 10, "For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost." If it was the priority of the Lord Jesus Christ, how about God himself? Let us see in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering towards what? Not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." I want you to look at the village that you come from. God is not willing that anyone in that village should perish, but that all in that village should come to repentance. I want you to think of the villages you cross when you are coming to the meeting here. You left your place, even those of us that are from Kumasi here, as you are coming, I'm sure that you'll find the people along the wayside. I'm sure you'll find some byways and some roads that will lead to some villages. The Lord is telling us that he's not willing that anyone, any single one, in any of those villages should perish. And those of you that have come from far, you would have come across many villages on the way. You would have seen many byways leading to many other villages too. And the word of the Lord is, God is not willing. God is not willing that any should perish. I'm sure that you will remember that in our cities and in our country, we have the prisons and there are those inmates there. And do you know it is not the will of God that any of those inmates in those prisons should perish? I'm sure there are some of you are teachers here and you come across these children in the primary school, in the secondary school, perhaps in the universities. And the Lord is saying that it is not his will that anyone that you see in all those places, that any one of them should perish. I'm sure you know that there are hospitals all around you. Maybe you've gone to visit one person before. And as you went to visit one person, you pass by a lot of beds, a lot of patients, a lot of people that do not know the way of salvation. And you didn't even care, you didn't worry about these people you passed by. You went to the person you went to. And then when you got to him, you didn't even check up, is he born again? You see a child of God, I see known assuredly that if he died in that hospital, he will go to heaven or land in hell. You didn't even check up. All you are interested in is, how are you feeling now? When are they going to discharge you? I hope you are feeling better. I hope you soon get well. And you never checked up. How is it with your soul? How is it with your heart? Do you know the Lord should a call come upon you in there on this hospital bed? Where will you spend eternity? The point is, as we find people, in all the places we find people, it is not the will of God that any of them should perish, but that all should come to repentance. You will see, therefore, that that was a priority of the Lord Jesus Christ in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, from verse 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, will thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the season which the Father has put in his own power, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. You can see the priority of the Lord Jesus Christ here. Do you realize the situation here? Jesus Christ had risen from the dead. And you know, before Jesus Christ died, he gave a lot of prophecies. And he revealed a lot of things. Just to refresh your memory, he revealed a lot of things concerning himself. Prophetic utterances concerning Jesus Christ. I'm sure you remember he said he will die. I'm sure you remember he said he will rise again. I'm sure you remember he said he will come again, as the Son of Man will come with the cloud and with the glory of God. He also said some things about the temple, that this temple will be destroyed. He said some things about Israel. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I would have gathered you under my wings, but ye would not. Because of that, I leave your house to you desolate. Said some things about other nations as well. Now, the children, the disciples of Jesus Christ wanted to know. Now we want to study. We want to know eschatology. We want to know about what you have in plan for the children of Israel. Will you at this time bring the kingdom to Israel? Or are we going to remain under the Roman Empire? Are you not going to set your people free? You are the Messiah. And as the Messiah, are you not going to fulfill what we have in Daniel? That I saw the Ancient of Days and the Son of Man, and with power he came upon the people, and even though they fought against what they says, yet he overcame them. Now, you not going to bring the kingdom back unto Israel at this time? Now, the priority of evangelism, he said, that's not for you to know. Brush that aside. The program of God is in his hand. The timetable of God is in his hand. Don't be inquisitive about that. More knowledge, more understanding, more eschatology, digging deep into this and into that. But then he said, but you will receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and then ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem. Suppose we fill Jerusalem with our doctrine, have we not finished? No. Then in all Judea. Suppose we saturate Judea with the gospel, is that not enough? No, you need to go to the half breed, the mixed up Samaritans, and you need to go to Samaria as well. After we've gone Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, have we not finished? Then he said, unto the uttermost part of the earth. Now you can see the priority in the mind of Jesus Christ. He wanted the people to actually evangelize and to do the work the way it ought to be done. And if we are following the Lord, evangelism should be on our priority list. It should be the number one thing in our lives, in our understanding, in our study, in our prayer, in our activity. In fact, any activity in our church, listen to this, very important, any activity in our church that doesn't have anything to do with bringing souls into the kingdom or teaching the people that have been brought into the kingdom, we need to re-examine that activity, whether it is of God or it is not of God. Because you see, there are many churches that have a lot of energy sapping activities, a lot of time consuming activities, a lot of things that they are the big things on the drawing board, but then it doesn't bring souls into the kingdom, and it doesn't confirm and teach and stabilize and make steadfast the people that have already come into the kingdom. We must make evangelism our priority. What's the purpose of our evangelism when it's a priority? The purpose is conversion. If our evangelism is just telling people, but they're not getting converted, informing them, but they're not getting converted, coming to programs, but they are not getting converted, and interacting with them, but they are not getting converted, loving them and caring for them, but they are not getting converted, doing a lot of things with them, but they are not getting converted. We have not done evangelism. The purpose of evangelism is to make sure that people are coming into the kingdom. They are getting born again. If evangelism becomes our priority, it will mean that every true believer in the local church is involved with evangelism. Every true believer. And if every true believer in your church is not involved with evangelism, do you know what is happening? What is happening is this, that God has given you maybe 20 talents, 20 believers. God has given you 100 talents, 100 believers. And every one of those talents should be made use of and should produce something in the kingdom of God. But then you are using only one talent, which is yourself. You see, you are a talent to the church, a gift to the church. All those believers are talents and gifts to the church. And if you end up just preaching all the time yourself, doing everything yourself, although you are using one talent, how about the 99 other talents that are there? Dormant, folding hands, warming the bench, closed in the mouth and closed in the mind, and they do not have anything reaching out unto the unbelievers around them. You must make sure that every believer in the local church, one way or the other, they get mobilized for evangelism. How do they do the evangelism? By their lives and by their lips. You do evangelism first of all by the life you live. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid, and neither does any man light the candle and put it under the bushel, but he puts it on top of that table so that it will give light, the light of the gospel, to all that are round about. So your life will shine with the light of the gospel. Your behavior and your conduct already goes before you to prepare the way. Then you open your mouth with your lips, you present the gospel. How do we do that evangelism? If it is priority, we do it spontaneously and regularly. If our evangelism is to come to the top of the list, if our evangelism is to be number one for us as individuals and for the church as a whole, it must happen regularly and spontaneously. How do we do that evangelism if it is to be done by life, by lips, regularly and spontaneously? If everybody is to do it, it must be with adequate knowledge of the Word of God. You see, if we're going to give the gospel to people, we need to have knowledge. What knowledge do we need? Number one, we need the knowledge of God. We need to know that God is not willing that they should perish. Number two, we need to have the knowledge of Jesus Christ. We need to know how to present Jesus Christ unto the people. It is not just inviting somebody to come to church. That's not evangelism. It's not just giving somebody a tract, although that's important, but that's not the totality of evangelism. It is not just giving a testimony of God is healing the sick, and God is opening blind eyes, and God is doing signs and wonders, and God is giving children to the barren. That is not evangelism. You know what the Bible says? The goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. The final thing is repentance. If the miracle doesn't lead the people to repentance, if the healing doesn't lead the people to repentance, the work has not been done. Evangelism is the goal. Leading them to repentance is the goal. They need to have adequate knowledge of Jesus Christ. They need to have the adequate knowledge of the scriptures. Now you will see, as you read in the Acts of the Apostles, you read that Paul the Apostle, or Apollos, and other people, they were convincing the people from scripture that Jesus is the Christ. That Jesus is the Christ. Which means then that you need the knowledge of the Word of God. Not only that, you need the knowledge of the sinner. You see, you need to know the sinner. Isn't that what the doctor does? The doctor will know a lot about the patient. Then he knows a lot about the pills, or knows a lot about the injection. He knows the patient, he knows the pills, and is able to match the two together, and is able to really give what ought to be given. And then you need to do it in the Spirit's power. In the power of the Spirit of God. You see, if we are going to evangelize, knowing that the purpose is conversion, and we cannot convert anyone, it is the power of God working with the Word of God that will bring the conversion. Therefore, the preaching has to be done in the power of the Spirit of God. So that's point number one, the priority of evangelism. Point number two, training for evangelism. training for evangelism. And this comes out of point number one. If we are going to make evangelism the priority, then we know that we have to train the people. Because you see, evangelism is not a natural trait. It's not something that will say, I was born like that. In fact, most of us are born with fear. Most of us are afraid confronting a stranger. Most of us don't even know what to say, although you want to do it, although you plan it. When you really come to the sinner, you are afraid to open your mouth. It is like, what will I say now if I open my mouth? What will I tell him? That is the reason why training is very, very important. So point number two is training for evangelism. In Matthew chapter 4 verse 19. Matthew chapter 4 verse 19. And it says unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. If I know you may know this verse, if you analyze the verse, it is saying there are two things here. Number one is the human responsibility. It's the human endeavor. It's what you do yourself. Follow me. That's what the people will do. Then it said the other part, which is now God's own work, which is now Christ's own ability. Then it says, I will make you fishers of men. And so training was necessary, and training is still necessary. If the people are following, they've left the world, they have come to the Lord, they are following the Lord, there should be a kind of training that will make them into fishing for men. Now let me ask you, here we are, many of us are adults. If I said now, let us relax and let us go to the riverside and let us catch fish. And I say, here is a net, here is a hook and a line, and here is a spear, and here are all the other things that, you know, the fishermen use. Pick anyone you want and let us go and fish. Oh, you say, I've never done that before. What if while I'm doing that, I fall into that river, I don't know how to swim? I've never tried it before. You need to be made fishers of men. You need to be trained. And you need to be exposed to, this is how it is done, the theory and the practice. And so Jesus Christ said, follow me and I will train you. I will make you fishers of men. In Mark chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. And he goeth up into a mountain and calleth unto him whom he would. And they came unto him. And he ordained 12 that they should be with him, and that he might send them forth to preach. He said that they will be with him, and then he will send them forth to preach. So then, as they will be with him, he will then expose them and teach them and train them and exemplify for them. Because, you know, we train by example. It will show them examples of actually how to win the lost. And so from there, we know that training is very important. In Ephesians chapter 4, from verse 11. Ephesians chapter 4, from verse 11 to verse 13. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. For what purpose did he give these leaders in the church? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. And in that verse 12, you will see that there is training there. You want to complete, you want to mature, you want to perfect the saints for the work of the ministry. And a priority of the work of the ministry is evangelism. And if you're going to mature those people, you're going to complete and perfect those people, you have to train them so that they will now be ready for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. When will the training stop? In verse 19, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the Son and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. As we're going to train people in evangelism, you will want to look at the model of Jesus Christ. Because, you know, in this passage it says, till we all come in the unity of the faith, unto the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man. We come to the fullness of the measure of the stature of Christ. How then can we train people in evangelism without seeing how Jesus Christ led people to himself, how he led them into salvation? You will want to pick up the individual cases. You will see how he approached Nicodemus, how he approached the woman by the well. You will see how he approached the woman that was already under conviction. Neither do I condemn you, go and sin no more. You will see how he approached the man that had been impotent all these 38 years and was healed, and met him later in the temple and said, you have been made whole, but sin no more, lest there was sin come unto thee. You will see how Jesus approached a person like Matthew that was at the side collecting the custom fees. And you will see how he approached the fishermen. You will see how he approached men and women and different kinds of people. You will see also how he approached the crowd, so he presented the gospel to them. You will see how Jesus Christ turned every situation into a means of evangelizing. Do you remember that some people came to give him news that Pilate mixed the blood of some people with their sacrifice? Immediately he began evangelism. He didn't want to comment on Pilate whether he was a good man or a bad man. He didn't want to get involved with their politics. All they said is that, do you think that those people are worse sinners than you are? And except you repent, you will likewise perish. Then he brought the current affairs and he said, even the people that the Tower of Siloam fell, do you think that they are worse sinners than yourself? I tell you, nay, except you repent, you shall likewise perish. You will see how Jesus Christ brought everything to direct their souls and to their gaze unto salvation, without which they will not be able to get to the kingdom of God. And so you will see Jesus Christ as a model, of a soul winner, the model of evangelism. And then you also see Paul the apostle, you see all the other examples in the New Testament, and you bring the people, that is the people now in the church, you see the, you see how to train them and teach them. At present now, if we think about all our members in our local churches, how can we evaluate the members in our local churches? In Hebrews chapter 5 verse 12. Hebrews chapter 5 verse 12. For when, for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one should teach you again, which be the very first principles of the oracles of God, and have become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. I want you to now think about your house fellowship, if you are a house fellowship leader. I want you to think about your local church, if you are a pastor. I want you to think of the women that surround you, if you are a leader among women. And I want you to think now, suppose we were to leave these people alone, and they were to go on their own, to go and evangelize, either in the schools, or on the roads, or in the market, or in the villages, or in the prison, or in the hospitals, or anywhere you find a concourse, a congregation of men and women. Suppose we were to leave them to go and preach. Do they all know how to preach? No. What do we learn of them? Well, that is exactly what I read to you in verse 12. They ought to be teachers by now. They ought to be soul winners by now. They ought to be preachers of the gospel by now. But then we are told that even for the time they ought to be teachers, they still had need that one should teach them. Which means that training is very much lacking in our congregations. And the one thing you want to take away from here is that you are going to go back home and develop a kind of training for the people, so that a time will come when all the true believers in that local church will know how to evangelize. As I talk about training for evangelism, let me give you seven points under this that I believe will be very important for you. Number one, preparation for training. Now you see that here we are, and we want to go back to our various congregations, and we see, I've told you already that if you have 100 believers in your congregation, and those 100 believers, they do not know how to evangelize, they are the raw material God has given you to train. They are the gifts and the talents God has given you to develop them, to train them, so that they can reach out in evangelization of your community. And as you are planning that you are going to do that, there's number one, preparation for the training. Now, if we're going to prepare for the training, if you have been a teacher, you know that in teaching we have a curriculum. In teaching we have a syllabus. And we know that this is the goal, what we are preparing them for. In the teaching, we have the curriculum, we have the goal we are preparing them for. And then all that we now develop is to fit into that goal. Then you sit down, you say, okay, this is my village. And we had about 45 people in our congregation. Among these 45 people, am I sure they are all born again? No, I am not sure. And I want to train them. What's the preparation I will make in training them? Well, the preparation I will need to make is to go back home and sit down and call the 45 people one by one. Not all together, one by one. And ask them, are you born again? Are you a child of God? Are you sure that your name is in the book of life? If he says yes, I write it as I'll get in touch with you later. You can go. I call number two. Are you born again? Just the same question. At the end of the day, I might discover that about 20 are born again and about 25 are not born again. Then I realize that these 20 people, they already have 25 people. And I myself, if I join the 20 people, we are 21, and then we have a kind of crash program. Because you see, these people are in the visible church, but they are not in the invisible church. These people already have the Bible, but they do not have faith in the promise of the Bible. Already have the word of God that presents Christ, but they have not been able to get that Christ out of that word and make Christ their own. But you see, they are easier because you can call them anytime. And then you bring them together, you prepare these 20 people, you preach to all those who are not born again and give very clear steps on how to be born again. And make illustrations and try to repeat a lot of things, and then you match them together to counsel them. You see, there are church members who are born again, church members who are not born again, and you help them. And now, once you know that these are born again, then you want to know, what preparation do I now need to train the people? At the end of the day, you might now discover that instead of having 20 people born again, maybe you now have 35 people that are born again. And these 35 people that are born again, we need to prepare them. If I'm preparing curriculum for some people I'm going to teach, I want to know what's the level of their understanding at present. What have they known? What do they still need to know? Then all the people in our community they are going to preach to, how are they going to reach them? What are the peculiarities of this village? The peculiarities of the men and the women that we're going to send these people to? What kind of difficulties are they likely to meet? What kind of resistance are they likely to meet? What kind of scriptures will they likely need? What are the steps I can give that will be easy for these people to grab and to understand and to go and give the gospel to these people? Therefore, you need preparation for the training. Number one, you need the pastor's preparation. You see, the pastor himself has to be prepared in heart. He has to be so prepared that come what may, this is number one project and program. And this is the most important thing. You prepare your heart, you prepare yourself by studying, and you prepare already, I've told you how to interview the people and get all these things done. Number two, the church's preparation. You see, sometimes you begin a training program like this and the church is not well prepared. They might be zealous for 1 week or 2 weeks, and after those few weeks, they go down again. Prepare the church. Number three, prepare the program. The program's preparation. Now, once you have that preparation, now you want to go to the next point, number two, priority of training. That means you realize that although you are so zealous for evangelism, although now you want to make evangelism your priority, and you're all worked up and stirred up, and you're saying, we're going to take this land for Jesus Christ. Everyone must come to the Lord. A lot of zeal, but there's no knowledge in the people. Therefore, you want to make now your priority to be training. And you are going to say, I may have to knock some things off from my life. I may have to knock some things off from the activities of the church, so that this evangelism training will then come to the priority, because this is not just going to be something we tag on, just something we conveniently get without making it the very central thing in the fellowship. You know that without the training, there is no success, so there must be priority. And you make this training higher than all the other activities. Number three, the program for training. Already I've taught this, let me just say this now. You develop a program according to the three levels we're trying to consider. Number one, you consider the spiritual level of the people that are going to use the program.
You see, this is the reason why sometimes some people who are very much excited about evangelism and try to develop a particular program, this is the reason it fails. Do you know why? They have seen a particular brochure. They have seen a particular magazine. They have seen a particular booklet and manual that they used in Canada on evangelism or evangelistic training. And they just bring all that without looking at the level of the people they are using that program for. If you are going to develop a program, number one, you look at the spiritual level of the people you are adapting the program to. Number two, the mental level. You see, there's something we call aptitude. The mental level, the capacity of the people you are talking to understand. I will think, for example, that people in Accra and people in Kumasi will be very, very different from people in a northern village in Ghana here. You know the reason why? Because their surroundings are different. Their educational exposure will be different, and their language and culture will be different. Their reasoning faculty and logic will be different. Because of that, you want to know the mental level of the people that you are talking to, that you are preparing the program for. You also want to see, number three, the educational level of the people. If most of the people are primary school leavers, if most of the people are language people that they do not understand much of, you know, this high grammar, illustration about computer, illustration about biochemistry, illustration about the airplane, illustration about the Kuwait war, illustration about all these things that you only know about them if you're listening to the news or you're reading the papers. If you know that they don't know all those things, you want to make that program to come to their level. Number one, preparation. Number two, priority. Number three, program. Number four, the period for training. Now you need the period because you want to know how much training are you going to give before you start sending the people out. The period for the training. After they have gone and they are doing the evangelism, when do you want to do another kind of training to make sure that the new people, prospective soul winners, are being brought into the training, and the people that were trained before, they're still having a kind of, we call it in-service training. They're already doing the evangelism, they're already doing the work, but you still want to keep on exposing them. So you are thinking of the period of training. And I break this down. Number one is the basic training. What period do you want for that basic training? Number two, what period do you want to have for a kind of intermediate level of training? How long will that be for the people? And as you want this intermediate level of training now, what is the kind of a target audience you are preparing these people for? What are they going to learn? What are they going to know that they do not already know? Number three, advanced training. That these people, you say these people, they are not like the others. For example, there are some of you who are workers here, and you are going to go back to the local church. You belong to the same church. And if our pastor in that church is going to develop a program, I hope it doesn't just make all the workers, all the new converts, and all the believers into one class, teaching everybody. There must be some people that are novices in evangelism that will take basic. There'll be some people that have been doing it and they have got a measure of success. The question they are asking is, when they ask me this question, why don't I remember the Bible verse? I'm going to reply them with. And when they dribble me this way, why don't I know how to avoid that argument and come this way and be able to lead them to the Lord? They want to be able to have a kind of intermediate training. And of course, to have some people that they've been in all these workers' retreats for more than 5 years. They've been coming and coming and coming. And they have been hearing about evangelism. You want to develop a kind of advanced thing for them so that they will still be able to have some kind of training. Number four, continual training. For all those groups, whether basic or intermediate or advanced, you want to be able to have a kind of continual training for everybody, that you just come like this and you expose everybody again, start them up again, so that they will continue in the work of evangelism. Number five now. Number one is preparation for training. Number two, priority of training. Number three, program for training. Number four, period of training. Number five, prayer and practice with the trainees. Prayer and practice with the trainees. You see, when you train the people to do evangelism, to do soul winning, you will need to also interact with them. Interacting with them to allay their fears. Interacting with them to give courage into their heart. Interacting with them to pump faith into them. Interacting with them to make them know how they can manifest authority when they go out in that evangelism. And you will need to pray, not just pray for them, you should pray for them, but you need to pray with them. You may have to pray with them just before they go out. You may have to pray for them on a regular basis, a programmed basis. You may have to pray with them as individuals. You might have to pray with them with the knowledge of the peculiar problems they have encountered as they have gone to do evangelism. You may have to pray with them as to the peculiar problems they have, even that is hindering them from going out in the evangelism. Prayer and practice with the trainees. Number six, patience and persistence in training. Patience and persistence in training. You see, as we train people, there are times that you will be disappointed with the assimilation rate of the people you are training. You see, it happens in primary school, secondary school, university, that sometimes you'll have a child that is not doing well in a particular subject. You don't take the child out of school just because of that, because he failed that subject, or because he even failed all the subjects last semester or last term. You don't take the child out of school because of that. You are patient and you are persistent in the training. You keep at it without looking at alternatives in programs. You know, the real thing that doesn't make the church to follow through in evangelism is that once there is failure, once there is a setback, they are looking for an alternative. And they say, I don't think that this evangelistic thing will work. I don't think that this going out two by two and talking to the people and reaching out to them, I don't think it will work. After all, look at the attendance of our church since we started this evangelism. And we've started now for 6 weeks. And the attendance is still the same. Well, the attendance may still look the same, but you may have more converts now in the church than you had before. You may have people now that are very sure of their salvation in that church more than you had before. You may have people that have Christ in them more than you had before. You cannot just go by the head count. But you see, there are some people, they are not patient and they are not persistent in training. Number seven, purity and power for the trainees. Purity and power for the trainees. If there is anything that makes us successful in the training and in the carrying out of that evangelism, it is because there is purity and there is power. Ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Then will you be the effective and the successful witnesses unto me. So let's go over this. Number one is preparation for training. Number two, priority of training. Number three is program for training. And number four is the period of training. Number five, prayer and practice with the trainees. You pray with them, you go out with them too. Number six, patience and persistence in training. Number seven, purity and power for the trainees. Let's now go to point three, which is the practice in evangelism. The practice in evangelism. Obviously, if we're training people, there comes a time you have to carry out the practical work to be done. And as you carry out the practical work to be done, you come to the practice in evangelism. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8 and verse 4. Acts chapter 8, verse 4. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Preaching the word. Now, if I were you, what I will do is that I will look at this verse and analyze this verse. Therefore, what is that therefore? It tells us about the persecution that arose concerning from Saul or through Saul against the church. It says even in the time of that persecution, to the point that even Stephen was killed and the persecution was so intense, the people were scattered. It says therefore, they that were scattered abroad. It tells us something very clearly. Even though there was persecution, even though there was what we call dislocation, they were taken away from where they were living. They couldn't carry their houses with them. They couldn't carry some heavy property with them. In fact, they ran away because of the persecution. Even in that tense situation, the people, when they went, they were not regretting, they were not sorrowful, they were doing evangelism. They must have been trained. Now let's ask ourselves the question: should persecution break out now? And should the majority of our people accept the pastor? Because you see, it says only the 12 apostles remain. All the other people were scattered. If that happened now, and all the people were scattered, what will you be thinking about? You'll be saying, how will they stand? You wouldn't even be thinking of evangelism. You know why? You are not trained then. They have not been trained to the point that evangelism becomes like their breathing. Evangelism becomes unnecessary to them as eating and sleeping. And even if there is persecution, you don't stop sleeping when you have to sleep. Even though there is persecution, you don't stop eating when you have to eat. Even though there is persecution, also you don't stop evangelism, because you have been so trained, it becomes so much part of you. It says they that were scattered abroad, they went everywhere preaching the word. And if I were you, I'll begin to think, as I think about the city in which I live, where would I say everywhere? And let me tell you something that you may not have noticed before. I want you to think of the house in which you live now. If you live in one single room, I want you to think in your mind, there are some places in your room, that single room, you never touch, you never get to in 1 year. That may be surprising to you, but that is true. Because you see, when you enter, you go straight either to the table, to the drawer, or you go to the bed, or you go to the place you have the box. You have about 3 paths within that room. And you always go to those places. And it doesn't matter what you are looking for, there are some places you never get to. That's by research. People have done the research and they have discovered that is true. If you're living in a big house, there are some rooms you never get to. Generally, you get to them once in a while. There are some places you always get to. There are some places in that house, although it is your house, some places you really never get to very seriously. And if you have many books on your shelf, there are some books you never even open in one single year. They belong to you. You even, if somebody says something and mentions that, we say, oh yes, I think I must have that book. You never touch that book. And there are some books you always touch. Am I right? Well, here we are, we're children of God, and you have the Bible. There is a page of the Bible you never generally open. When you open it, you're looking for John chapter 3 verse 16, and therefore you pass by every other thing. And if I were to call Amos chapter 3 verse 2, you'll have hard time knowing that verse. You know verse 3, you always go there. But Amos chapter 3 verse 2, I doubt, and it's an important verse, very, very important verse. I'm not going to read it to you now so as to test you whether you will go and look at it after we finish the survey, after we finish the message. But you know, there are some verses like that you never touch. If you look at your Bible, some pages are dirty, some pages are brand new. Why are those pages brand new? Because you never touch them. I said that to say this: in a city, there are some areas the church never gets to. You'll visit your member here, you overlook this house. You'll visit that house fellowship there, you overlook this whole street, because you have no interest there. You are not doing anything there. That is why it is very important you'll begin to think in your mind, therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere, preaching the word. You want to analyze your city, and you want to know what is everywhere. Where are the places we have been overlooking? The places we have been neglecting? The places that look untouchable? Therefore, you need to find out so that you will plan your evangelism very well. Now, in this area too, because of our time, I'm going to give you 7 points as you think about the practice in evangelism. Number one, readiness of each member to evangelize. The readiness. You have trained the people by now, and you have located all the places where we need to preach the gospel. You have identified the needy areas. You have identified the age groups. You have known the teenagers that we need to reach. You have known the bachelors we need to reach. You have known the spinsters we need to reach. You have known the widows and the widowers that are neglected. We need to reach them. You have also identified the aged people. Identified the aged people that are neglected generally. You have identified the people that are illiterates that are generally neglected. You have looked at the people that normally go to night walk or night shift, and the church has no program for them, because you see, when you are having the church service, a lot of those unbelieving people, that's the time they are sleeping, because they walk all through the night, or they even go to work during Sunday, during the day. And you want to look at all these areas of people. How do we reach them? And having studied all that, you now prepare the church, and there is a readiness of each member, so that you can follow through on your thorough preparation. Remember, point two, you've done your thorough preparation. Now there's readiness. Number two, regularity in evangelistic practice. Regularity in evangelistic practice. You see, it is not enough to just rise up and in the spur of the moment with great zeal to go out and evangelize, but then you need regularity in evangelistic or evangelism practice. You want the people to develop it into a habit, so that no matter what is happening in the rainy season, in the dry season, it has become so much in nature for them that they are very regular in evangelizing. Number three is resistance against temptation in times of discouragement. You see, it happens to every worker. I'm sure here you are, there are times you have been discouraged yourself as a worker. There are times you've been discouraged as a house fellowship leader. And as people that are winning souls, when you really begin it in real earnestness, there will be times that there will be temptation to get discouraged. And you want to teach the people and train the people to know how to resist the temptation to stop. Resistance against temptation in the times of discouragement. I'm not taking temptation now the way we took it in the morning in the message. That was a good message. But I'm now talking about temptation to stop evangelism. I'm not talking of temptation to commit adultery. I'm not talking of temptation now to, that story of that man that said he was praying for somebody while closing the eyes. And, this fellow had undressed. And I'm not talking about that temptation now. The temptation to stop evangelizing. Because the temptation will be there. The temptation will be there to say, after all, what is the result? What is the effect? What have we got in the evangelization? You will resist that temptation yourself, and you will teach your people to resist that temptation. Number four, reassuring the weak and restoring dropouts in evangelistic practice. You see, here is the place where the pastor will need to be vigilant. You have trained the people. You have brought them together. And as you have brought them together, they have been evangelizing. Along the way, there was a temptation for them to get discouraged. So you help them so they can resist that temptation. And then comes the necessary point of reassuring the weak. Because you see, some of the weak people will say, am I really qualified to do it? Is it of any use I'm involved? Will I be rewarded at all? Look at the many problems in my own life. If the people ask me, okay, you say that Jesus Christ can save, and you are inviting me to know Jesus Christ, how about your own life too? That's the time you need to bring reassurance to the weak. And then you need to restore the dropouts. You're always checking up. We started with 20 soul winners. We started with 26 soul winners. And the following week, you're still checking up. And the following month, you're still checking up. And if there are dropouts, the people that, they have dropped out of the evangelism, you want to restore them. You say, no, you cannot drop out of it. It is compulsory. You cannot stop eating or stop sleeping or stop praying or stop reading the Bible. And you cannot stop evangelizing. It must continue. Number five, remembrance of the value of souls. What keeps us going on, even when we appear to be tired, is because we remember the value of a soul. We know the soul is more important than the whole city. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and he loses his own soul? Or what shall man give in exchange for his soul? Because you always remember the value of the soul, and you're always reckoning the value of souls in the light of eternity. Always reckoning the value of those souls in the light of eternity. That is the thing that will keep you on. Number six, renewal of consecration. and recovering of the lost axe head. The renewal of consecration. You have consecrated your heart and your life and your time and your possession to evangelize. And all the time you'll bring everything back to the altar again. You say, Lord, another new week is beginning and I'm renewing my consecration. That, Lord, until the last soul has come into the kingdom of God, I will not stop evangelizing. I will not stop preaching the gospel. I will not stop inviting the sinners to come and know the Lord Jesus Christ. Renewal of consecration and recovering of the lost axe head. Do you remember that story? That the sons of the prophets, they were in a place and they told Elisha, the place where we dwell with thee is too narrow for us. We want to go and cut down wood so that we can have a more spacious place. And he said, go. And he said, be it a pleasing to you to go along with us. And he said, I will go. And then they went to the side of Jordan. And the Bible says that while they were cutting, the axe head fell into the river, into Jordan. And he said, at last, my master, for it was borrowed. And he said, show me where it was, and he showed him, and he cut down a tree and threw it there, and the axe said swam again and floated again. I said, put forth your hand and take it, and he took it and put it back again. Now they can continue cutting the wood. Many people lose their axe head and they keep on cutting with the wood. They keep on preaching, they keep on cutting, and they say, I don't know why there's no convert. Check up the axe. You see, there's no more axe head here. And because of that, let's remember the tree at Calvary. When you throw the tree at Calvary to that situation, the power you lost, the conviction that you lost, the sharp edge of your preaching that you lost, the insight into how to penetrate into the souls of the people you lost, everything will float again. And Jesus will say, put forth your hand, you take it again. It has been restored unto you. You keep on evangelizing. Renewal of consecration and recovering of the lost access. Number 7, reporting regularly. Reporting regularly to the Lord and to the church. Reporting regularly. That is very, very important. You are not just going out as an isolated soul winner, as an isolated person that is preaching the gospel. You want to report back. You report to the Lord every day. And if you report every day, it will make you to know whether you are doing it or not. And when you want to pray in the night to go back to bed, you say, oh Lord, I want to report to you today what I have done. All of a sudden you realized you never spoke to anybody today. And with tears and with guilt, with conviction of the Spirit of God, and with a new promise that, Lord, oh, how sorry I am. I wanted to report what I have done today, but I saw that nothing was done at all. Then you apologize, and then the first thing you do tomorrow is that you say, oh Lord, I'm going to pay for even yesterday. I'm going to double what I'm going to do today because I missed out yesterday. You're always reporting to the Lord. That's not the end. You are reporting to the church. You see, you are a part of the body. You are a part of the congregation, and there is a leader over you. You have a pastor, and therefore you're always coming back and you are making a report. Here is what I've done. Here is the result. Here are the difficulties. And while you report, you recommit your life to God for continuation in evangelism. You recommit your life to the Lord for continuation in evangelism. I want to add to one of those R, and it is the result of evangelization. The result. Now, what is the result? And I close with this illustration, an example. Take a local church. And in this local church, let us say that we've done the training for just these 10 people who are born again. And if in your church you have 20 people, then have these 20. If in your church you have 50 people, then think about the 50. If in your church you have 100, think about 100. Now, let me start with just 10. Let's say that in your local church you have 10 people, and these 10 people are born again. If I were you, I will go back home and get those 10 people together and challenge them. I could take this cassette and play the cassette to those 10 people. Not the whole church, just these 10 people, because I want to start with them as a nucleus. And these 10 people, after we listen to that cassette, then you, with the fire of God in you, you also address them. And you say, now, here is the target and here is the goal before us. We are going to do this work. and you get there with the grace of God in your life to agree with you that we're going to do this work, and then you say, we are going to trust the Lord that as we're going to get the training, even for the rest of this year, at least each of us can have only one convert. Oh, there's only one. Don't let us be in a hurry. We can double it later. Just let us aim at one convert at present. And you aim at that one convert. At the end of the year, 10 will become, shout it loud to wake those who are sleeping. 20. Thank you for waking them up. Now, you have 20 at the end of the year. And then at the end of the year, you recommit yourself again, because you know there is the training that is basic, that is intermediate, that is advanced, that is continuous. Because of all that training going on, these 20 people again, they recommit themselves. And they say that now for this year, we're looking for just one convert. And 20 at the end of the year will become 40. At the end of the third year, they have woken up, don't they? I'll now tell you, since everybody is up. Now, at the end of the third year, you are going to have 80. At the end of the fourth year, you are going to have 160. At the end of the fifth year, you are going to have 320. At the end of the sixth year, you are going to have 640. At the end of the seventh year, you are going to have 1,280. Now, think of those of us who have been in our churches for 7 years. And in those 7 years, maybe you have only grown from 10. 7 years ago, maybe now you are only 46 or 47. Because you try to do it all by yourself. Because you try to do all the preaching. There's no training. There's no evangelism. There's no regularity in evangelism. Let me change the number. Let me take a location, a church that is 100. Not just 100 counting the heads, 100 believers in that church. And there may be some of you here, especially in the capitals for the regions, where you already have, you can say, by the grace of God, I can get 100 believers. If they win, only one. And you are going to train them. You have to train them. That's what the reason we've been talking of all this. After that training, just 1-1-1. Every year, at the end of the year, you are going to have 200. At the end of the second year, you are going to have 400. At the end of the third year, 800. At the end of the fourth year, 1,600. At the end of the fifth year, 3,200. At the end of the sixth year, 6,400. At the end of the seventh year, you are going to have 12,800 in that location. You know why? Because you are training the people. And because you are making sure, you are saying, brother, this is May. Your combat for this year, you have not won him. When are you going to win your combat for this year? When are you going to develop him? When are you going to put the work into his hand? When are you going to reproduce? Are you not concerned about it, that you have not got your combat for this year? And what you are just thinking about is, you preach your normal services, no special crusade, no loudspeaker system, no printing of handbills, no buying of generator, no taking permit to use the stadium, nothing whatever, just one-to-one evangelism. And with those 100 people, you start with them and you carry through on the training. Before you know what is happening, you will understand that everything will change. There's another thing that you are going to have as a result. Another result you are going to have is that, look at us here, the workers' retreat that we have here now, although we appear large, but it's just like last year, almost. If we were doing this type of thing and training people and reproducing leaders and reproducing soul winners, what will happen is that if you have 2,000 workers this year, by the time you come next year, you might discover that you already have more than 3,000 workers. By the time you come the following year, you might just have more than 5,000 workers, because you see, there is an ongoing kind of training, and these people are actually doing the work. Do you know what? And these people that are already doing evangelism, they're going to develop. You're going to have people moving up. He was a soul winner, he's going to become an evangelist. He was an evangelist, he's going to become a teacher. He was a teacher, he's going to become a pastor. You are going to have a lot of people available. In fact, you have so many workers that you may even begin to send out missionaries. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Here is the great commission given unto us, and we need to make it a priority, the priority of evangelism. We need to train the people. Training for evangelism, we need to practice it, practice in evangelism. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. This is what we need as a church. And this is what we need to commit our lives to as a church. Talk to the Lord in prayer. It must be done. It will be done. It must be done. It can be done. And it will be done. Can you commit yourself to training? Training the people. You need to study. You need to prepare. You need to pray. You need to practice it. You need to show the example. You need to be zealous about it. You need to be committed fully, completely unto it. And you need to exalt this kind of evangelism to a priority level above all the other programs that are not bringing souls into the kingdom of God. Let us do it, we can do it. Let us do it, we can do it. Let us do it, we can do it. We can do it. Don't sleep, please pray. Don't sleep, please pray. You must be involved. This is not only for the pastors, it is for every one of us. When you get back home, all those workers in this retreat, get together with the pastor and let us see how we are going to carry this out. Do it because it can be done. Do it because it was a priority in the ministry of Jesus Christ. Plan to do it. Plan to do it. Sit down and work it out. Put the time down when you will start. While we're still here in this retreat, you as a pastor, think about the church in your village, the church at home. Put it on paper that this is the time I'm going to begin training and practice for evangelism. Let nothing hinder you. It must be done. There must be no excuse. It must be done. It doesn't need generator. It doesn't need loudspeaker system, PA system. We can do it starting from now. It doesn't need spending money. It can be done even from now. Plan to do it. Plan to do it. Resist the temptation to discouragement. Do it. The results will be wonderful. I call on Brother Edward Dodo to please come and pray for us.
Amen. Our Father, we thank you very much for this time and the word that you have shared with us. You have shared your hearts with us that it is not your will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Systematically, patiently, you have taught us how we can get everybody converted without the people being perished. Father, we are praying that the message of this day will not slip out of our hands and our hearts in Jesus' name. Every time you call us together to challenge us, so that we're able to rise up and do something for this generation. But no sooner have we left, we threw everything aboard. Father, we are asking that this message will continue with us, and we begin to put everything into practice till we see the reality of the word of God in our lives and in our churches in Jesus' name. Father, all the procrastination, all the tricks the devil brings upon us to make us to be distracted and attracted by things which do not count for eternity. Father, we are asking that all such things will be taken out of our ways in Jesus' name. Father, we pray that the message will be so fresh, be so moving, and you continue to motivate us till we sit down to work out a workable plan whereby every bit of the message will be practicalized and we see our churches growing in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, we are asking that the wisdom of God from above will come upon every one of us. The compassion of Christ from above will come into our hearts. The zeal of the Lord will consume every one of us in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, after we have known all these things, if we fail to do them, it will be a labor lost, time wasted, energy wasted, money wasted, and everything will be a loss. Father, we pray that every one of us will not find it easy to brush this message aside. In the night, Father, continue to talk to us. In the day, Lord, remind us. Everywhere we are, Father, we pray that the message will be recalled back to our memories and it will fill our lives and every part of our being will be missed and we begin to work at it in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, we pray that you help us to be good examples to the members of the congregation. That this work of evangelism, which is uppermost in the heart of God, will be uppermost in our hearts also in Jesus' name. We are not just going to preach evangelism. You want us to practicalize evangelism so that by our lives, the people will just see and they begin to preach even before we tell them in Jesus' name. Father, help us to be at this work of training, which has cost us so much in the church, that we begin to work at it and see that the people are well trained and they'll be able to join us to fight till we see our nation, our cities, our towns, and our villages won for the Lord in Jesus' name. Father, we depend upon your grace. We depend upon your power. We depend upon your spirit. Help us to do it so that in the end, your name will be glorified, and we also will have the fullness of joy, and the blessings of God will come upon our lives, so that we be a blessing unto all people in all nations. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. We are able to go up and take the country, to possess the land from Accra to the north. Though the giants may be on their way to hinder, God will surely give us victory, victory. Up and take the country, to possess the land from Accra to the north. Though the giants may be on their way to hinder, God will surely give us victory, victory. We are able to go and take the country.
Praise